As you reflect on this last legislative session, an especially busy session, what were the successes?
I would say the successes were our ability to make investments in the state of South Dakota unlike any other year ever. We put $660 million, I believe, into water projects, and I can't think of anything that will enhance the future of South Dakota any more than investing in water projects, whether it be for economic development or for rural areas or for municipalities, both large and small. That's an amazing, amazing amount of money, but what it did was it advanced our opportunities by at least 25 years, just because it would have taken us that long to be able to accomplish what we've got in the works right now. And the process that we put in place to accomplish that, I've got all the confidence in the world that this is really going to work. We didn't reinvent the wheel. They used the water board, and it's an application process, and there's a percentage that has to go to certain rural areas and whatever, and so I'm very confident about that and just really excited about the things it can do.
And I remember from day one that was something you were highlighting as a major
absolutely.
Opportunity.
And the other thing was going to be the housing money that come along. I think that that's just a very substantial amount of money. Again, $200 million in a state like South Dakota, that is amazing. But the process there, it's all brand new. The water process was in place, but this is a bit new. And so we'll just have to monitor that, see how well it's going. And the legislature has the opportunity, if we need to tweak some things or change a few things to make it work better for the state of South Dakota, I think we can do that. We invested this year in universities like no other year. Just absolutely amazing, and it's all just really exciting stuff. I think the money we're putting into Madison, DSU, those folks they're coming out of there with job offers that rival people that come out of Yale and Harvard and beyond. It's just they're six-figure numbers for young people coming right out of college, but. They're in the right industry and they know their stuff, and so that's really exciting. All of the different things that we've put together, investing in the nursing programs across the state, making them regional, so it makes sense for some young person that wants to go into nursing to be able to do that without disrupting their lives. They can maintain their some kind of a job and still be able to participate, but we're going to have a nursing shortage, and so all of these things are going to help alleviate that. One of the bills that I put together and sponsored was the research facility at Cottonwood. That'll be very, very important. That research facility's been in place since 1907, and they've been there, done some really, really groundbreaking research over the years, but right now, with that kind of investment we're going to put in that, it'll allow for a feedlot, feedlot series that'll have, you can have your control groups and you can have several different experiments going at the same time. But like for instance, a lot of the environmentalists are blaming the cattle industry for causing a lot of pollution and carbon into the air, and with this industry, with this research that they're going to do down there, number one, they'll be able to experiment on things that will reduce that, but they can also do some research to go a long ways towards proving that it's actually a different set of circumstances that we're dealing with when you deal with methane coming from a live animal. And I've already seen some of that research, not necessarily from South Dakota here, but from other places, that prove that that particular greenhouse gas degrades really rapidly compared to emissions out of a internal combustion engine or something like that. So all of those things and grazing research, and I'm just excited about a whole lot of things. But to invest in What we were looking for is we didn't want to spend one-time money on for ongoing costs, and we didn't want to, and we wanted to make sure that those investments that we made were investments that would pay dividends to the state of South Dakota and to the nation and to the world for decades. And I really believe that all of that, we accomplished all of that.
Yeah. Especially, I think it's common for folks in maybe the more urban parts, like the Sioux Falls, those areas of South Dakota, to lose track of, especially for those water projects, the need there. I wonder if you can highlight, maybe specifically for your district, or other examples that you can think of, what this is going to mean.
Well, what this is going to mean is the money that we're investing is going to enhance a lot of the rural water systems, number one, but it's also going to replace that aging infrastructure in the small towns and the big towns. A lot of those small towns were established right after the turn of the century, and the sewer or the water systems are such an aging infrastructure that they've got to be replaced for so many reasons. But it's just going to make all the difference in the world for the state of South Dakota. But the other thing that a lot of people miss is we also made provisions to invest in the research and the engineering to do the mega water project that's been proposed to bring water from the Missouri out to West River, South Dakota, out to the Rapid City area and Pine Ridge and Union Center. They're talking about a 6-foot diameter pipe, and it's thinking in the right direction. It's what I've always said is if you spend the public's money and do a project, and if that project doesn't serve the people for at least 50 years, you've wasted their money. And this is something that'll do that.
A lot of successes this session. Did anything get left behind?
Oh, you know, everybody's got an ox that gets gored during the session. And, there's a handful of things that I would have liked to seen, but overall, there's never been a session like this, and I don't think that we're probably, I doubt if I'll ever see a session like this in my lifetime again. It was a perfect storm where a lot of federal dollars came together. The economy last year, because the governor did some really wise, made some wise decisions on leaving the letting personal responsibility be the rule of the day, and so our tourism business just went out of sight. We outrun everybody, and along with that, just allowing businesses to do business. So with that, we had revenues that were also above expectations, and you throw those two together, and we were able to do a lot of really good things.
We've heard about a differing vision for things between the House and the Senate. And I think an example of that was Senate Bill 117. It was hoghoused a couple different times, came back to the Senate as a bill to repeal the food tax. That amendment was brought forth by a House Republican.
It's the process. I mean, it's all good. And yeah. What I always say, there's 105 legislators in the system, and I truly believe that all 105 really have the best interests of South Dakota in mind. The only difference is they're all looking to make South Dakota a better place to live. The difference is the path to get there. And so and that's where your differences come in. And so like for the repeal of the food tax, the tax on food, for myself, what I looked at was the last time the state of South Dakota got a significant influx of federal dollars, within 2 years of that, the governor asked for a 10% across the board cut on all of state government. That's huge. That is huge. And it caused some pain. So I look at this and I look at that and I see some similarities. The other thing, if you look to our neighbor to the north, they had the that oil boom up there, and they wisely put a certain percentage of those revenues aside in a trust fund that couldn't be touched for I forget 5 years or 10 years, something like that. But within, and there was a proposal to eliminate property tax at that time when they were getting all of that money coming in. Within 2 years, they were in serious, they were trying to, scrambling to make the budget work. And so these kind of things, you don't want to base your decisions on the current, your current situation. You want to do like the famous hockey player. You want to skate to where the puck is going to be. And so that's what you got to think ahead about those things. So we don't want to hurt people, but we don't want to put ourselves in a bind either.
Have you seen a divide grow in the Republican Party in South Dakota?
Oh, you know, any time that you have a supermajority, I don't care if it's in South Dakota or Hawaii, anytime you have a supermajority, what you're going to do is you're going to create a situation where the, cowboy logic, where you circle the wagons and shoot in. And so it sometimes it creates that opportunity to do that, because in other situations where it's closer to 50-50, you've got to hang together to get anything done. In this situation, we've got a supermajority, so that necessity isn't necessarily there, so it creates the opportunity to create some factions within the party.
What kind of challenge is that for a majority leader?
Well, as majority leader, my philosophy is I never have told anyone how to vote. I try to make sure that everyone is heard in the caucus, and I try to make sure that the both sides of an issue are heard. And if it's something I feel strongly about, I might make some comments, but try to get the caucus to move in that direction. But if you try to push things, it never works.
When you think back over all your time serving in the State House, what was that original inspiration that brought you to public service?
Well, I think prior to serving in the legislature, I served as a county commissioner. And I saw the things that the legislature did had a direct impact on the county governments and different things. And I just wanted to have an opportunity to have at least a fingerprint on that and try to move it in a direction where it works for all branches of government, but aside from that, where it works for the citizens.
What are you most proud of?
You know, at the time, I was involved with when we raised the gas tax, and it seems a little odd to be proud of raising taxes, but it needed to be done. And in South Dakota, overall, our road system is pretty darn good. It really is, and we can always improve. And there's opportunity to invest more money in that. But it was a deal where we hadn't done anything for a good long time. And we worked with the engineers and the folks that know what's going on and could see where we were headed, and we were headed in the wrong direction. And I think because of that, we were able to advance road projects quicker than they would have been otherwise. And in that particular case, it was 6 cent raise, and the week it went into effect, the gas dropped about 10 or 15 cents, and the 6 cents went into place, and hardly anybody. The biggest comments I got out of that was within that bill, I don't know if you remember, it raised the speed limit on the interstate to 80 miles an hour.
Oh, that was the best part.
Well, you know, I got a lot of compliments about that, and I didn't hear hardly anything about the other way. But the one thing I did notice is the only people that complained about the speed limit going to 80 miles an hour on the interstate were the folks that were approaching 80 in age. So it was kind of interesting. But we did the, you know, we were able to get the teachers closer to the market on different things. This cottonwood research facility, I'm really I'm really proud of that, that we got that across the finish line. We've just through the whole process, and a lot of states use some accounting gimmicks and different things to make it look like the budget is balanced, and it is not. And that's one thing. We do not do smoke and mirrors, and we have balanced our budget for now 133 years in a row at a AAA bond rating with all of the different bond rating companies, which saves just millions of dollars. And the state of South Dakota doesn't use the, you know, bonding very, I don't even know if we've got anything right now, but the universities and the schools and the cities, all of those benefit from that stellar bond rating that we've got. That's a huge accomplishment. And the other thing that through the years, the retirement system we've got, nobody has a retirement system that is funded at 105%. I believe it's not been very long ago, Kentucky, I think their retirement system was funded like at 35%, and they had to use some accounting gimmicks to get that accomplished. And that thing it hasn't collapsed yet. They're either gonna have to do some significant contributions out of the general fund, or it's gonna collapse, which would be an absolute travesty. And so I'm really proud of that. I really believe we've got some of the top people in the world managing that investment fund for us. Just top-notch people, and they do a great job.
Senator Heinert, in his last remarks on the floor, gestured to you as his neighbor, said some touching things about your working relationship. What would you like to say about your relationship with him and some of your other colleagues?
You know, Troy and I had an amazing relationship. We just were really, I think that when you're dealing with someone from the opposing or the other side of the aisle, again, I point back to my comments earlier. He has the same goal that I have, just a different philosophy and a different way of getting there. And he brings things. He brought, over the years, he's brought just done a good job of representing the people. And the thing that I always did was that while we're in caucus and we make a decision on maybe changing the order of the calendar or doing some different maneuvers on the floor, I would have my intern, when we made a final decision there that would be announced shortly on the floor, I'd have my intern go ahead and send him a text so that he could talk to his caucus before they came out. So communications. And I never viewed Troy as anything but a friend. I never considered him a opponent. It's just a friend that had a different philosophy. Oh, I would say that the South Dakota legislature has a great process. Nothing becomes law without being under the microscope at least five times. You've got the committee of the House Origin, you've got, then if it gets out of there, then it goes onto the floor, and then you've got all of these lobbyists that are going, the different industries that are represented there. You've got all those folks going through that bill word by word, punctuation by punctuation, and then it goes to the other house, goes through the same process, and then it goes to the governor's desk and it gets dismantled and gone through again. So the chances of unintended consequences are less, but even with that system, we still end up with that how the heck did that get there, you know? But it's a good system. 551 bills were introduced this year. There is no, in other states, there's what they call a pocket veto. If a chairman of a committee looks at a bill, doesn't like it, he folds it up, puts it in his pocket, and never sees the light of day again. And we do not have that. If a bill is introduced by a legislator, it is going to be heard. And so and it's a really open process, the committee process. If someone happens to be walking by a committee and sees it's a, something of interest to them, they can walk to the back and they walk to the back of the room, sign their name, and come up and testify before the legislature. Just very, very open system. And so I'm really proud of that. And then again, the fact that we always balance our budget, it's just huge. And it doesn't have you in South Dakota, you get to taking those things for granted, and it's just doesn't happen everywhere.
What's next?
I started out in the House of Representatives, served 2 years there, served 8 years in the Senate, and I have taken out a petition to serve in the House again. And so we'll just see. A little matter of an election, and we'll just see how it goes. It's in politics, friends are friends and enemies accumulate, and so it's the longer you're around, it seems like you pick up some baggage as you go, but I'm hopeful to be able to serve another term in the House.